It's a pleasure to be here today. Thank you for the introduction. I guess I'm going to be talking for about half an hour, and I welcome very much a discussion on what is a real complex, but at the end, simple set of issues and solutions for what could be a serious climate crisis, some of which appears to be coming our way already. I have here a few books that you can have, because they are just five. I don't know what happened to the rest. We probably didn't send them. And also copies of the presentation and some media information about our company. Oh, thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Thank you. This is a... today, this morning, I received a copy of this article, which is an interview in a journal called Global Policy that this institute subscribes to, which covers some of the topics I will be talking about. So Jutta was kind enough, thank you, to make copies, and I have copies here for not many people, but there is a few, in addition to the other material here. Jutta was also so kind to make copies of the presentation itself. And as I say, we're going to go into questions, and that to me is the most interesting part, because I have heard myself talk before, as you can imagine, but I haven't heard you. So I am more interested in what you have to say, but I do understand that I go first, okay? That's the rules. Okay, so here's a story. This talk is about avoiding extinction, and the subtitle is the Paris Agreement that you must have heard about, and global thermostat. And that's an unusual juxtaposition of terms, because the Paris Agreement is the latest UN agreement incorporating 195 nations last December, in which appears to be an overwhelming support, not just by the scientific community, but also by the nations of the world, for the need to restrain and avert potentially catastrophic risks of climate change. Global Thermostat is a company. And what's interesting here is we're going to talk about a private sector solution to a big global policy issue. This, I understood from Stephen, is very much what the Institute, the American Institute for Economic Research, is doing or trying to do. So you may have the impression that we were well organized when we prepared this presentation. Let me disabuse you. It's a pure coincidence, but it's a very good coincidence. So here is what the first thing that I want to say. You may not know that. And this is that according to the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, Fifth Assessment Report, that was 2014, and the Paris Agreement, that was last December, 2015, we now need carbon negative technology as the only way that we can avert climate change. And what does that mean? It means it's not sufficient to go carbon neutral. We have to actually remove the carbon that is already in the atmosphere. The reason is that carbon dioxide as a gas stays for hundreds of years once emitted. So it's not like you emit it and you know what, it will go down to the floor or will somehow recycle. No, sir, it stays there for hundreds of years. And we emitted so much that now we had to take out what's already there. And that is what is called direct air capture of carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is CO2. Direct air capture means you go to the atmosphere and you take out physically the CO2 that is there. Any chemical engineers or physicists here? Okay, the reason that's difficult to do is because the quantity of CO2 in the atmosphere is very diluted, it's very small. 400 parts per million are carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. That's very small. Therefore, it is unusual to have a technology that can separate the carbon dioxide as we are doing. Yet, What I'm going to tell you has been proven, demonstrated, has been awarded prices. It is under commercial, is commercially demonstrated and moving forward commercially, and is in the process of making revenues, as well as having developed and patented with 19 patents valid in 147 nations, our technology as well. I'm a co-inventor of the technology, and I am one of the founders and the chief executive officer of the company. I can tell you it's a lot of work. So the climate challenge, something that you heard about, is what I told you before. Here we have all the CO2 up there in the atmosphere, and the challenge is to take it down. So global thermostat, which in this presentation is called GT, Global Thermostat, answers this critical challenge by profitably capturing atmospheric CO2 for productive industrial uses, creating abundant, reliable, low-cost supply wherever needed. The diagram there shows how the CO2 in the atmosphere has been increasing, and it is well known that this is the greenhouse gas that makes the atmosphere opaque. So when the sun rays come in, they cannot leave, therefore creating what's called the greenhouse effect and increasing temperature. Now, if you read this article that Jutta was so very kind to print for us, although the print is so small, I doubt that you can read it. Never mind. Nothing is perfect in this world, but you can read it. So the first question that people ask is, so what is the threat of climate change? We know it's getting warmer, but it's just going to be nicely warmer and softly warmer? Uh-uh. It's neither nicer, not softer. Let me just tell you. Right now, the North and the South poles are melting. And this is where most of the ice is in the planet. If you ever prepare a drink, you know that when ice melts, it increases the volume, right? Which means that when the North and the South Pole melt, as they are melting right now, seriously, and Greenland ice sheet melting, the oceans are increasing their height, which means the sea level rises, and there are 43 nations, which are island nations, that are going to simply go under. And important areas in the world, such as Shanghai and Miami, are going to suffer trillions of dollars in economic losses. Now, I just want you to focus how this can happen. It happens because a hotter atmosphere and body of water, which is connected because the water takes up most of the CO2 that we put out, mean more energy, more volatility, and more intense and powerful climate events, like typhoons, like tornadoes. So think of it this way. New York City, the superstorm Sandy, right? Instead of having one, there will be three. Every year, three superstorm Sandys. Just think about it. Months, schools closed, no police, your farm is closed, there is no electricity, there is no water, the cars are floating on the streets. If that happened three times a year for several weeks, several months, New York would not operate. That is what we're talking about. It's not mild, it's not soft, it's pretty serious, and that's what it says there. Now, when it says there that we take the CO2 and we sell it for productive industrial use, then you say, the what? This is supposed to be a joke. So at this point, I advise people to laugh. Now, that was a joke itself. What happens is that when you tell people, when people say, what does your firm do? And I say, we take CO2 from the atmosphere and we sell it for industrial, productive industrial use. They say, you take what and you do what? It's not a clear explanation. So let me give you the clear explanation. We take the CO2 from the atmosphere and we make dollar bills out of it. That is a technology. Sounds like a good technology to have because there is so much CO2, right? And how do you make those dollar bills? Well, let me tell you who buys the CO2. Coca-Cola, have you heard about them? They buy CO2. Pepsi-Cola, heard about them? They buy CO2. You actually produce plastics using CO2. So IKEA can produce furniture from CO2, furniture from air. And Coca-Cola can reverse the trend from being a capitalistic company that is presumably harming the atmosphere along with the rest of capitalistic society to the, what I call the redemption of capitalism. Why? Because you drink Coca-Cola and you clean the environment. I love it. When I told, when I told this to Coca-Cola, they said, that sounds good to me. And the same thing is true for Pepsi. I can't give you details, but on the 23rd of this month, watch out for Forbes magazine. Forbes magazine is publishing an article about this company, which they think is changing, rewriting the rules of, you know, corporate development and corporations as a whole and capitalism, according to Forbes, right or wrong. So they are writing a big article, and they claim we're going to be on the cover of the magazine on August 23rd, which is just around the corner. Watch out, we are going to be there. And in the articles there, you see that we are all over the place. And we have biggest publications such as New York Times, and just about every publication you can think of has actually written articles about it. And I will be showing you a Scientific American video very quickly about our company that they did recently as well. So this is serious stuff. So now you know what the company does, you know why the company does it, and how do we make the money? I didn't tell you, but CO2 is needed to desalinate water. Think of California and Israel and the Middle East. Are they desalinating water? Big time, they need to. They need CO2. Synthetic fuels. You can produce fuels like gasoline from water and air. By taking the hydrogen from water and the CO2 from air, you mix them and that's identical molecule by molecule to gasoline. That's another example. So I just said drinks, desalination of water, plastics, and synthetic fuels. We have contracts with Australia who have a network of greenhouses in the whole continent that we are serving and selling CO2. Why? Because CO2 is what plants want to eat. So if you want plants to grow faster, give them CO2. They love it. So that's what we have to do. Take it down and feed it for Coca-Cola, for Pepsi, for greenhouses, for synthetic fuels, for plastic, for everything I'm telling you now, and make a lot of money. Why make a lot of money? Because Adam Smith was right. The way to scale up and to make things happen is not to convince governments. The governments are, I notice, are not perfect, but people will go for activities which are positive and make money for them. And that is what this is all about. So the global policy is the issue, that if you want to look at the issue of global policy here, and as I said, you can look at it from the point of view of global policy or business, and you will hear both, is that the Kyoto Protocol, Carbon Market, which I wrote, which is explained in that book, Saving Kyoto, can provide funding, and does provide funding. The Kyoto Protocol carbon market by the year 2012 was trading $175 billion per year. And each one of those dollars was going to use by activities that decrease the CO2 in the atmosphere. They could all be used for developing carbon negative power plants. What's that? If you come to our plant and you are all invited, seriously, in Silicon Valley, Menlo Park, 333 Ravenswood Avenue, you will find that in the literature here. This is the biggest technology campus in Silicon Valley. 63 acres, that's where the internet was first created. And we have an operating plant, and you will see the pictures of this operating plant, and which you can visit. And this plant is cleaning CO2 from air and also from the power plant that runs the Stanford Research Institute, SRI, so it does both. And it takes off more CO2 than what puts out. Now, if any of you knows where is the problem originating of climate change, almost half of the emissions come from power plants. So in this, with this technology, we transform the worst emitter in a cleaner. With this technology, power plants can clean the atmosphere, seriously clean it. I can give you the numbers and I can give you the articles, instead of emitting CO2. A 400 megawatt power plant emits typically 1 to 2 million tons of CO2. Using our technology, they can be reverted to before that are extracted and captured. -2 is 2, so that plant, instead of emitting 2 million tons, will be cleaning 2 million tons from the atmosphere. I can send you all the documentation as well. So this means we can build power plants. That means serious economic development. Where? Here, everywhere. Economic development is the access to power, electricity. And typically, the problem is that power plants are the biggest emitters. With this technology, as we have working and operating in Silicon Valley, we clean the power plant in Silicon, at SRI, and we take off more CO2 from the atmosphere. That's called carbon negative power plants, okay? Those carbon negative power plants are our invention, and they can provide economic development. Sorry, economic development? That cleans the atmosphere. Now, this sounds nice. It's not nice, it's revolutionary. This changes the equation. It means that in order for human beings to grow the economy, we don't need to ruin the environment. It turns things around. That's where we should be going. And if you look at the article that Jutta was so kind to print that appeared this morning in the journal Global Policy, which the Institute here has, because they're subscribed to it, and therefore you can get it, or you can get it online, you will see that it explained word by word how this type of technology provides economic development that cleans the atmosphere and changes the notion of GDP, gross domestic product. It changes it completely in cooperation also with the use of the carbon market, which provides a value for the emissions, a negative value, and a positive value for cleaning the atmosphere. So global policy is still needed. I didn't say it's finished, and I had to go faster with your permission. I created the Green Power Fund, which consists of $200 billion a year used to build carbon negative power plants to overcome the serious, tragic, not just serious, problem of poverty in developing nations, in which 1.3 billion people are below the level of consumption of basic needs. And of course, they don't even have electricity. This can turn things around. In 15 years, at $200 billion a year, we can build these plants. 30,000 of these plants suffice to take out all the CO2 that humans emit in the atmosphere. But wait, that money is not a gift, it's not a cost, it's project finance, which means that by operating the plants, they will make profits. So the money is not required, and it can actually come directly from the carbon market and its clean development mechanism when you're dealing with developing countries. I will respond to that if you need to in the questions. So I created this Green Power Fund in Copenhagen, and it was partially adopted by the United Nations as a law, another law that I created in addition to the carbon market, and this is the Green Climate Fund. I will talk more now. However, more global policy is still needed because the carbon emission limits of the Kyoto Protocol are now expiring in the year 2020. We need to expand them. But the Paris Agreement got agreement from all the nations, 195 nations, that this is a very serious problem, but did not provide any emission limits like the Kyoto Protocol did. So carbon negative technology facilitates staying within carbon limits, and therefore people cannot object to it because you can use the building of carbon negative power plants to stay within your carbon limits, create sources of energy and profits. So it's not costly to the economy to meet those limits. On the contrary, it's just an innovation that you adopt and everybody's better off. It's a win-win. Carbon removals is what they are called, and they are part of the Paris Agreement. There are four articles I inserted myself in the Paris Agreement in COP21 in December 11, 2015. And I can talk about those if you wish, and I have publications on that. However, and this is the totally innovative point about this presentation, and I have to accelerate because I'm running out of time, that this is not a problem that I believe governments are going to solve. Governments have a lot of problems, and you may have noticed they are not 100% effective. Even when they want to do the right thing, they may not be successful in doing it. So I'm saying that business must solve this policy problem. For business to solve it, it has to make sense economically. So let me talk about that. And I will now talk about the business of Global Thermostat, with your permission. This is not a promotion for the firm. I mean, yes, it is, if you wish. I'm just giving it to you as an example. Please understand there would be other technologies, and in fact, there are other technologies. And if we are very successful, they will be competitors, and they are competitors right now. And if we're even more successful, there will be a lot of competitors. And that's good, not bad, okay? We are ahead of the game, and it's important that I tell you how this works, but make yourself no illusion that we are talking about a whole industry of carbon removals, not just about one company. I just talk about this company because I know it so well and I can give you the examples. What you're looking there is the first pilot plant that we built directly at the SRI International, which was formerly the Stanford Research Institute, very near and part of Stanford University, 333 Ravenswood Avenue in Menlo Park, California. You can go and see it. Now, you cannot just walk in and see it. You have to write to me about it. Well, nothing is perfect. And there is also a lot of government work. There is a lot of army work there. So you need to get your IDs and stuff like that. But this is it. That was the first pilot plant, 2010. I don't know what happened to that. Okay. We now have a second one, and you will see the pictures coming. But the thing to point out here is that there is an enormous demand for CO2. This is what matters to a business. Are you going to produce something for which there is no demand? What for? If you want the private sector to help, you have to build something that the private sector wants to buy. Well, there is a huge unmet demand for CO2. And this documents the industrial markets, including food, beverages, enhanced recovery, refrigeration, because CO2 is what's called dry ice. Greenhouses to produce vegetables, carbonates, which is like carbonated drinks, concrete and cement, polymers, plastics, graphene, which is a very valuable industrial product, cropping. You know something? Automobiles now don't use metal anymore. They use carbon fibers. That's CO2. Carbon fibers. You know, the last BMW has no metal. It's all made of carbon fibers. Carbon fibers are stronger, cheaper, and lighter than metals. And now all the bodies of the of airplanes are going to, and the ships are going to be done. Most of the private ships are made of carbon fibers, and they're going to be made for the large carriers as well. Algae biofuels, synthetic gasoline, enhanced oil recovery, etc. And the question is why there is so much unmet demand? And this is because CO2 doesn't like to be transported. Typically, you have to build pipelines. They are incredibly expensive. They are $1.5 million per mile to build, and nobody wants a pipeline. Well, guess what? We don't need pipelines. Why? Because we take the CO2 from air, and the air is uniformly endowed with CO2. So I could put one of our plants in this room. Uniformly means that right now in New York, in Beijing, and in Madrid, Spain, it's the same concentration of CO2, which means we don't need to transport it. We just put one of our facilities next to Coca-Cola and they can use it right there. Therefore, saving a lot in transportation, which is difficult, expensive, and provides limited supplies. We have unlimited supplies. There is so much in the atmosphere. We put out 30 gigatons, which are 30 billion tons of CO2 per year, so that you know. Now, I'm going to give you an introduction video that can explain this quickly. Then I will tell you, I will give you the Scientific American video, and then I am more or less finished.
In the atmosphere, carbon dioxide is a potent greenhouse gas. And as CO2 levels rise, we're inching ever closer to catastrophic climate change. But here on the ground, carbon dioxide is a valuable commodity in multiple large and emerging industries, including enhanced oil recovery, synthetic fuels, and industrial gases. The market for CO2 on Earth is nearly $1 trillion per year. CO2 is in high demand and increasingly short supply. Global Thermostat is commercializing and has built operating plants of a multi-patented technology that economically captures and concentrates CO2, enabling its profitable sale and reuse, making money while reducing harmful emissions, cleaning the atmosphere, and helping to close the carbon cycle. GT is the first and only company that can capture CO2 from both industrial smokestacks and also directly from the air, and it can do so at remarkably low cost. Recently, the UN found that capturing CO2 directly from the air, as Global Thermostat does, is the only way to avert catastrophic climate change. In short, GT turns pollution into cash, transforming carbon dioxide from a global liability into an immensely profitable asset. It accelerates the transition to a renewable energy economy.
Okay, now we're going to see this one, which is Scientific American.
Carbon dioxide.
Carbon dioxide.
The greenhouse gas, carbon dioxide.
CO2 is the gas everyone loves to hate.
Levels not seen for 2 to 3 million years.
Scientists tell us if atmospheric CO2 continues to rise, our lives will change and not for the better. But capturing it at smokestacks or from the air is extremely expensive. Unless you can reuse that CO2 to make a profit. Peter Eisenberger is a researcher and inventor who views CO2 as a great opportunity.
It is what life's about. We're all made out of carbon. We make our energy out of carbon. It's really a very positive molecule. And the problem is we're not managing it right.
It already comes in quite handy. We use it in fire extinguishers, dry ice, and of course, soda. For decades, oil companies have used this gas to create more fuel, pumping CO2 underground to squeeze more oil out of wells that are drying up. Now a new breed of entrepreneurs believes we can use CO2 emissions as a raw material for a wider range of products. One of the major goals is to create new forms of energy that have no carbon footprint. One process would inject CO2 into a type of underground brine methane aquifer, which would force methane to the surface where it could be collected and sold, while the CO2 remained underground. In another line of thinking, Eisenberger's company, Global Thermostat, intends to capture CO2 out of the air and use it to feed special algae floating on seawater. The algae is processed into biofuel and a substance called biochar, which stores CO2 in soil. The process, if scalable, would be a carbon-negative source of fuel.
I think that that's where we're going to be going, collectively as a species, trying to find ways to mimic the energetic and structural way that carbon is used by the rest of life, and use our knowledge and our technology to do that even more effectively than nature does.
There. That's the current plant, which was built in 2013 and is still operating, and it shows the steps for the technology. First, the air input, then the carbon capture, which separates the air from the CO2 using a proprietary sorbent, which is based on a Corning monolith, the sorbent produced by BASF for us. Then through heat transfer, we separate the air and the water from the mixture of CO2 that is produced by injecting water vapor. And then we have a regeneration of the sample, which means the sorbents Once they are depleted of CO2, you can reuse them, otherwise it would be too expensive. And I told you that this market for CO2 is flooded by demand, and I wanted to show you an article from the Cryogas International magazine, which is actually a magazine put out by the industrial gases profession, that shows how there is much, much demand for CO2 on Earth, and there is too much up there, too little down here. Our platform of technologies is really a radical change. What you see here, in addition to myself, is Peter Eisenberger, who was in the Scientific American video, and Ben Brofman, the son of Edgar Brofman, our chairman, and one of our investors. Our company has raised, I have raised $31 million in investment so far. We are in the process of raising another 25. We have 19 patents, valid by treaty in 147 nations, and we have 5 commercial projects right now under construction, right now. This is the commercial demonstration plan that you can see if you come to SRI, 333 Ravenswood Avenue that you saw before, and that is the power plant behind it at SRI that is being cleaned by our technology and also taking additional CO2 from air. So the combination of the power plant and our technology is carbon negative. It's operating there, and you can come and see it. It has third-party validation and tests and demonstrated effects, and this is what the commercial size demonstration plant technology looks like. I think it will be too much to go forth to this audience, but I repeat so that you remember afterwards, what do you do with the CO2? Biofertilizers, industrial gases, food and beverages, building materials like plastics and cement, synthetic fuel, seawater desalination are just some of the markets. This is why the commercial value proposition holds. We are the lowest cost producer of CO2 in the world, the most scalable because the units are one next to the other, so what we have built already is already commercial size, doesn't need to be made any larger. No transportation is required. I told you that's the most expensive part of CO2, and carbon negative, which means that we remove more carbon than what is emitted. These are 5 commercial plants that we have under construction right now, commercial plants in the United States for industrial gas markets, for carbonating classic beverages in Germany to produce plastics, and desalination in Israel with a global power company, GTLF, and in Australia providing CO2 for Australian solar group for a network of $650 million worth of greenhouses. It may be interesting to you that Fast Company, the magazine, and I saw it here, I saw it one issue here, has in April 2015 found that this company, Global Thermostat, is the world's top 10 most innovative company in energy. I was given the award from IAIR at Yale Club in New York City of the 2015 CEO of the Year. This year, Company Energy chose as the 50 most innovative company in renewable energy. And we are a finalist award from NYSERDA, from the state of New York. Here you see myself, Dr. Peter Eisenberger, who you saw in the video, and our executive chairman and lead investor, Edgar Brofman, who used to be the CEO, founder of Seagram, also Warner Music. So we have a combination of scientific, business, and marketing and business, experience power into this. This is some people from the advisory board. We have a very prominent board made mostly of Exxon or former Exxon executives. And this is my contact. We have an office in New York and Princeton here, and our laboratories are in Atlanta and in Silicon Valley at the SRI, and these are the contact information. So this is it, I finished.
So you have patents, and what was the cost of that installation in Silicon Valley?
The cost of installation is less than $1 million, which is incredibly low cost. It takes about a year to build one of those, and one of those of that size will be able to provide between 10 and 100,000 tons of CO2 per year, depending on the materials and the solvents. And the ton of CO2 sells between $50, $100, or even $200, depending on the market. So if you sell the CO2 at $100, and you are producing 10,000 tons a year and pay $1 million for producing it, that means you are getting $1 million of revenue every year. So in the first 2 years, you have covered the capex. And then you, every year, you have the rest is OPEX, but of course a lot of profits. And that means that if you look at the IRR, it's pretty high, between 30 and 40%, depending on how you integrate the computation. So for a levelized capital model of 10 years, devaluating the capital in 10 years, this is highly profitable and it has high internal rate of return. Yes.
Do you imagine building lots of these plants all over the world?
Yes. First, I will say one more word about what I said before. So essentially, you can think of it this way. With $2 million, you can build a facility that produces 10,000 tons of CO2 per year. And for example, for greenhouses, that's $200 per ton. So 200 times 10 is 2,000. So it's $2 million a year. So you make $2 million a year, and that's what the capex costs. So you can see you recuperate the investment very quickly, and the rest is profits. That's one example, but every plant has to be looked at on its own, profit and loss. Yes, we want to expand, and we are in the process of doing so, but we first have to complete our first five commercial projects that I described before, because that's the typical evolution of a technology. You invent it, patent it, so you have the IP secured, then you develop it, then you have to go through what the Army calls technology readiness levels, and we are technology readiness level 9, according to the US Army right now. The next one is the commercial, which is now in the process of happening. Once you do that, you need to scale up. How much? To take out all of the CO2 that humans are putting into the atmosphere, which is 30 gigaton or 30 billion tons of CO2 per year, you need to build 30,000 of those. Not five, not 10, 30,000 of those. So it better be profitable and it better catch up. That's where Adam Smith comes in as big help. So we can build it in Africa, and Africa by itself can clean the atmosphere of the entire planet, which would be great, is one, and grow, and economic development. Any other question? Yes. Can you please give your names? Name?
Dennis.
Dennis O'Connor.
Oh, Abby Wunschlegel.
Sorry?
Abby Wunschlegel.
Abby?
Abby,
last name?
Von Schlegel.
Von Schlegel. Abby Von Schlegel. Your name?
Super, Neil Holden.
Sorry?
Neil Holden.
Neil Holden.
Yeah. When wheat was domesticated, studies have shown that the carbon dioxide was higher than now.
Sorry?
When wheat was domesticated, meaning a long time ago, the carbon dioxide levels were higher than now. And I kind of wonder about your catastrophic projection. I don't doubt that you might have some global warming, but I don't believe the catastrophic stuff. But if you start cranking all this up, what are you going to do about trees and plants? I mean,
perfect answer.
The plants would do better at higher carbon dioxide levels.
Yes. The levels that we have of higher dioxide currently are more than sufficient for the Earth's vegetation. In fact, the Earth was in a balance for the carbon cycle. The carbon cycle means that Animals breathe oxygen and exhale CO2. Plants breathe CO2 and exhale oxygen. So until now, the two were in balance. And the levels of CO2 that we had before the industrial levels, which were 200 parts per million, less than half of what we have now, more or less, that was enough and more than sufficient for the plants.
Actually, you know, 5,000 years ago, it was much higher.
Sorry?
It was much higher 5,000 years ago.
It was what?
Much higher carbon dioxide levels.
Carbon dioxide levels did and do go up and down over time, naturally. The one thing that we do know is that we didn't have this at the current levels. We did not have for millions of years this level of concentration. So if you ask my opinion, I think it is possible for life on the planet to adapt to much higher levels of CO2. It is possible, but not quickly. So what's going to happen is that if we increase the levels of CO2 as quickly as we're doing through the Industrial Revolution, we don't give time to evolutionary forces to adapt. So the current life in the planet will perish, and there will be a big change. For example, let me give you an example. 60 million years ago, there was a large asteroid. You can see it in the article of mine that is written. There were 60 million years ago, there was an asteroid that hit planet Earth. And what happened? The clouds of dust covered the sunlight, and all the vegetation and life that was depending on the energy from the sun, which means all of us, perished. At that time, the dinosaurs were the species that were in control of the planet. They were the most powerful species in the planet and more distributed, like we are now.
12,000 years ago, we had another one, roughly.
True, but I wanted to refer to the 60 million years ago.
All the mammoths and so on like that.
Yes, I wanted to. Yes, indeed. There have been five large, big extinctions in the planet, and this is number six. Of those six, all six were caused by climate change. And we are causing climate change ourselves by the emissions of CO2 now. But here is the problem. The dinosaurs, 60 million years ago, when exposed to that major climate change caused by the asteroid, they went extinct. But when a species goes extinct, it doesn't disappear universally. Sometimes there are little pockets that remain here and there. In particular, in that case, the dinosaur that could fly above the clouds of dust and receive sunlight, some dinosaurs could fly, those dinosaurs survived. So now those dinosaurs are believed to be the birds and the chicken. I believe that if we continue with this unparalleled use of resources, of which the atmosphere is one, and the other one is bodies of water and biodiversity, human species could perish. And I explained how a few minutes ago. I can explain more now, and it's in the articles. But what's interesting is that not all humans will disappear. There will be pockets. The equivalent of the dinosaurs that could fly, there will be some humans that can survive. But the dinosaurs that could fly disappear as the species that we had before, the same way that humans organization will disappear as a species, although there will be some that will survive. The dinosaurs became the chicken of the present. Will humans become the chicken of the future? Possibly. Any other questions? Yes.
So, say you build 30,000 plants, will you not exceed the normal demand for CO2?
That is a critical question. What's your name, sir?
John Olander.
John Owen is asking, okay, you can take all the CO2 you want, and maybe you can build 30,000 plants. Good luck to you. He didn't say that. I'm adding that. Because we need good luck, right? he says, where are you going to put it? Who is going to buy all that CO2? Okay, so we have done, as you can imagine, serious computations about that, and it's a serious question. It won't be Coca-Cola. They buy very little CO2. They buy 1.5 million tons globally, but the Coca-Cola account at $100 a ton means $150 million that they buy of CO2 every year. So I had to take that account as a business person very seriously. It's recurrent, $150 million every year. Now you say, I know, don't talk to me about dollars. If nobody's going to buy it, what dollars are you going to get? There is enough need for building materials. Where? In the US? No. The US is past its peak for building. That was Eisenhower. Now, we use building materials here, but the real demand for building materials that can absorb all that CO2 is in China and is in India, it's in the developing countries. So yes, there is, but what's going to happen is there is a transition now happening where the economy is starting to use more and more CO2, replacing other materials, because the CO2 is in the air, it's free, just get it out. And you can use it for replacing metals, for doing plastic, building materials, etc. And if you go for the demand that is coming from the largest developing nations, yes, there is enough demand to absorb 30,000 million tons of CO2 per year, not today, 5 to 10 years, depending on the current slope. And but the question is, yes, there is. There is. But what's happening now is that automobiles, for example, are more and more made with carbon fibers. Planes, the same. Metals are being replaced by carbon fibers. We are using CO2 instead of using petroleum to build plastic, et cetera, et cetera. That transition is a transition to a new economy. It's a new economy that is not based on petroleum. It's a new economy based on CO2. CO2, we believe, is the molecule of the 21st century, like petroleum was the molecule of the 20th century. Yes, sir. And your name?
Yeah, John Barry.
John what?
Barry.
So
from an investor's perspective, you made a strong case that you can probably produce CO2 cheaper than conventional sources.
What?
You can probably produce CO2 more cheaply than conventional sources, right? You can make that point. And number two, there's growth in that market for a greater consumption of CO2, right? That would suggest that your company is viable enough, right? Absent any discussion of global warming.
Oh, yes.
So why do you talk about global warming?
Why? Because I came here to give a presentation, and I think people will get very bored if I start talking about how profitable my company is going to be. Otherwise, I won't. If I talk to investors alone, yeah. I simply talk about the company and what the company is doing. And yes, our costs are the lowest cost in the world, except for the free sources of CO2, which are more or less exhausted. There are areas that have something called CO2 domes, where the CO2 is basically free. But the transportation is not free, and it's the most expensive part.
But it's a viable entity absent any discussion of global warming.
Yes, he's right. What's your first name?
John.
What John said is right. As a viable commercial entity, he said, don't bother me with global warming. It's confusing the issue. As an investor, I don't want to talk about global warming because it blends together a commercial enterprise with an enormous headache, which is the international policy, which never works. And I did say the governments don't work. Well, if the governments don't work, all the governments of the world together, which are at the United Nations Convention of the Parties, were given less. So yes, he's right. I am tying the, almost like appearing to tie, the future of our company to a non-working engine, which is the international governments, or the United Nations. Why should I do that? Well, whether you believe it or not, because I believe that it motivates me and my partners to seriously do what we're doing. It's not just a way to make money. It's a way to transform the world economy, economy in a way that it needs to be transformed. And I do believe that capitalism needs to be transformed. And if you want me to, I will talk about that, but I have an obligation to answer the questions about the lecture first, and then I will refer to that very briefly. Yes, John.
Marge Turner. I'm just curious what your business model is. Do you plan to build the plants and sell the plants, or build the plants and own the plants and process and run the process at the end of
the day? Latter. Selling equipment is not a very good business. Selling the CO2, which is recurrent revenue, is a better business. Mm-hmm. So we build a plant, we own the plant, we lease it, and we sell the CO2. And the CO2 is a very valuable commodity, and it gives you recurrent revenue. Give me one example. Coca-Cola. I already said that, so I'm going to repeat it. Coca-Cola buys 1.4 million tons of CO2 per year. And they charge not themselves, well, in some cases themselves, but their franchisees, which are the bottlers. They pay somewhere between $100 and $500 a ton. At $100 a ton, which is a minimum price, it means that the Coca-Cola account every year buys a recurrent revenue of $150 million. Recurrent. So if you have that account and you sell to that account, and I should tell you that we're negotiating with them, but I'm not telling you that because it's confidential. I can't talk about it. But that account is worth $150 million every year of revenues. Any company that sells $150 million a year worth of revenues is worth billions, at least $1 billion and more. Therefore, this is a very valuable market. Pepsi, the same. And I didn't even mention plastic markets, and I didn't mention the water desalination markets. So this is a huge market. There is a lot of profits here. We are, like John said, the lowest cost producer of CO2. And the reason is that from day one, I said, this is not worth doing unless we do it at the lowest cost. Then it can be profitable, then it will scale up, then business will do it, then we don't depend on governments, and then it will work, not just to make money, but also to turn around the climate change problem. Any other question? Yes, sir.
Hello, my name is Greg Van Kipnis.
Greg?
Van Kipnis.
Oh, sorry?
Van Kipnis.
Good. Greg Van Kipnis. Yes, sir.
So my question. You've talked about the problem that the world faces. You've talked about, I'm going to sort of summarize what I think I've learned.
You were asleep.
Yes.
That was a joke. That was a joke. I said you were asleep. Never mind. Don't worry about it.
So you've told us that there's this global problem of global warming, that it's been identified by some organizations, but they're not really doing anything about it. You are part of a venture group that has developed and perfected a technology that can solve the problem.
Yes, sir.
So does that mean the good news, that the problem is on its way to being solved? Is there any other impediment to solving the problem?
That's a very good question. Answer, yes and no. Let me explain. The answer is yes. This technology and others like it, Greg, can solve the problem and can solve it while helping the global economy. So that's a good solution and it will happen. The problem is time, how long it takes to happen, because we are close to the point of no return. The climate is not something you can turn on and off. And if we don't do this reasonably soon, the atmosphere will fill with CO2, and then it's a point of no return. I told you that CO2 in the atmosphere doesn't go away. It just stays for hundreds of years. If you reach a very high level, it will stay at that level, and it's very, very difficult to turn it around. So that's what is called the point of no return, and there is a lot of literature on that. Question, can you do it soon enough? Answer, I don't know.
But you have a capitalist solution. You can produce it cheaply. So it's just a marketing problem from this point forward.
It's marketing and it's execution. In other words, you have to actually do it. And it's also a strategic issue. Which markets we're going to address first. Suppose we only address Coca-Cola and Pepsi-Cola. We'll make a lot of money, but they can't absorb all the billions of tons. So we have to address Coca-Cola because that is the market. Why is Coca-Cola the market? Listen to that. Because Coca-Cola is capitalism. I sold this to Coca-Cola saying, you know, this is a transformation of capitalism. This legitimizes the fact that capitalism can turn around, that it may have been a negative force on the environment, but now it can be the force that cleans the environment, which is what Greg is saying. Therefore, Coca-Cola is extremely important, but they don't have enough volume to absorb all the CO2 that we need for the climate change solution. But yes, this is the solution to climate change. Yes, it is. Can we do it soon enough? I don't know. And it takes decades for the adoption of the most obvious technologies. A very good example is the fax machine, which nobody uses anymore. But it took, I don't know, 40, 50 years to be adopted. And there are all sorts of network effects and resistance against new technology, etc. So right now, the energy market is one of the slowest to change. Remember I showed you our award that we were awarded by this magazine called Fast Company, the world as the world top 10 most innovative company in energy. Our little company competing with Exxon. We were competing with Exxon and we won, okay? I didn't know that, they did it themselves. Well, when I received the award, I said that I'm very grateful, of course I am. And I also said, but I'm highly suspicious. Because the bar is very low. The energy industry does not innovate, or does not innovate very much. So you're giving us the award as the world's top 10 most innovative company in energy. It's a very low bar. Just want you to. Energy is very, very difficult to innovate in that industry. The industry doesn't innovate very easily or very fast. So I hope Greg's implicit suggestion that the problem is solved, I dearly hope, Greg, that you're right. Anybody else? Yes, your name.
Evan Seitz.
What?
Evan Seitz.
Evan Seitz.
So the oceans naturally sequester a great deal of carbon dioxide.
Yes, sir.
But this directly causes the rise in acidity, which is causing a massive ecological disaster.
Yes.
Does your company have any technologies that can address this? Because we're already seeing massive die-offs on the coral reefs and other areas, and even if we can remove the carbon from the atmosphere, we're still dealing with this incredibly difficult and challenging problem.
Yes, Evan is right. The 80% of the CO2 that is emitted is being captured by the oceans. And when you take up all the CO2 into water, water becomes acidic. And the oceans are acidifying at an alarming rate. And as a result, watch, every animal that has an external skeleton, like the, the krill, what?
Turtles?
Yeah, krill or any animal that has an outside skeleton, okay?
Mollusks especially.
No. Mollusks are the ones that will survive, because they don't have calcium-based skeletons.
No, but it's, I've been doing some research on this, it's harming their mucous membranes.
Yeah. Well, it's harming everything because the pH balance is critical to life. But typically, the mollusks are more likely to survive than the krill, which are the basis of the life on the planet, eaten by all fish and whales and everything, that are not going to survive because their skeleton is external and is made of calcium that is diluted by the acidic water, the same way that 50% of the corals out of the coast of Australia have disappeared because they are basic, they are calcium, and they are being destroyed by the acidic waters. So The question that you ask is, don't we have more serious problems than just the CO2 in the atmosphere? He's right. I'm going to respond to that question. Yes, there are three major problems. If you look at my article that is there, I wanted to start with this, but I say no, they're going to kick me out. And, you know, people are already, it's just too long. I will take 1 minute. There are three major problems, or at least three. There is the atmosphere, we spoke about that. There is the hydrosphere that Evan is talking about, which is the bodies of water. And he's giving one example, which is acidification. There is others of the problem. For example, California, we're out of water. What are we going to do? That's true all over the world. Water is the most scarce resource in the planet right now. By the year 2050, there isn't enough water for the people in the world to drink, to survive, okay? So just think about it. So the atmosphere, the hydrosphere, and the biosphere. Now watch. Humans need food. And if they don't get food, they die within a few weeks. Humans need water. If they don't get water, they die in a few days. Humans need clean air. If they don't get clean air, they die in a few minutes. We are destroying the sources of food, water, and clean air in the world. And if you look at what is the issue behind it, it's because our economic systems are outdated. So we don't give any value to clean air, clean water, and biodiversity. What to do about it? We need to create limits on the use of biodiversity, water, and air, clean air or atmosphere, the biosphere, the atmosphere, and the hydrosphere, and allow those to be traded. Those are new markets. Those new markets create a new form of capitalism that I call green capitalism, with new measures of GDP, which are consistent with human survival. Currently, our GDP that gives no value to clean water, no value to clean air, no value to biodiversity, gives no value to human survival, which depends on those three. Therefore, our current economic system is giving economic rewards to the destruction or the extinction of the human species. I'd like to give one example, which is the fact that if we killed all the trees in the planet and produced toilet paper, the GDP in the planet will increase very significantly, and here too. The reason is that there is no value for a standing tree, even though it cleans the air, as pointed out. And it is critical for many reasons for humans. We need to change that. You need markets that give value to these three fundamental basic needs of drinking water, clean air, and food, biodiversity. So the way to do that is to put limits on the consumption of those three and allow those to be traded. Out of those come a price. This becomes like the carbon market, which is already international law. So what I'm saying is not a pipe dream. It's part of the international law already. We have to do more. So that goes back to Greg. So there is a solution. Create those markets. Not so fast. It takes time. And by the time we create it, all elephants may be gone, all sea mammals may be gone, and very soon humans could be gone too. Yes, John.
Can you just follow on from what I was saying before then? What you're talking about is pricing an externality, right?
Yes.
Economist problem. But
John, you must be an economist.
Somewhat. In order for your firm to survive, it is dependent on the pricing of those externalities, or is it not? Or is it can it exist independently, as I said before?
You're going back to the same point you made before. It's the same point. We don't need to price externality. Right now, our firm makes money because CO2 is in tremendous demand by the current regime of capitalism that gives no value to a clean atmosphere. Do we need the international policy to make this firm succeed? No. We deliberately build a firm so it will be profitable and the technology without policy, without any international or national governments agreeing or having any laws or anything like that. Totally independent. It will be helped by pricing the externalities, but it's not needed for our farm. Does it answer your question?
Yeah, so has your firm forsworn any type of lobbying or policy influencing?
Is our firm what?
Does your firm agree, is it part of its charter to not influence policy through lobbying or any other device?
No, we don't influence policy or stop from influencing policy. That's irrelevant for us. However, it's not irrelevant for me. I have created international law 3 times. And I think it's very important to have the international law if we're going to hope for the survival of our species. We are in a very tenuous situation now. So I believe we need international law. I have created it 3 times. The first one was the concept of basic needs that became the definition of sustainable development and adopted by 150 nations and then became the group of 20. Sustainable development is the group of 20 leading agenda. Then I created the carbon market of the Kyoto Protocol in 1997 that started trading $175 billion by the year 2012, and I wrote it, and it became international law in 2005. And the third was the creation of the Green Power Fund that was ratified partly. I presented it to Secretary Clinton when she was Secretary of State, and it became the Green Climate Fund. And it has now $10 billion, which is nothing, but it has some money. And then I created 4 articles that I didn't tell you about in the Paris Agreement, in which carbon removal is required, is awarded the international funding from the carbon market, and is measured in various different ways. There is an obligation to report on carbon removals. I can give you the articles, I can give you everything about that. So yes, I do that in my free time. But the company doesn't have the right to lobby for that. The company, however, because of the way it was organized, has a special treatment for developing nations. So it offers a break on licensing cost for poor nations. And that's good business, we think. Good business, because they are the best customers. China and India, the best customers. Particularly if China was not a thief in technology, which is another topic that we're going to avoid right now. Yes.
My name is Honey Sharp. And I was wondering, you know, you were talking about the capitalist partnerships with, say, Coca-Cola and the plastic companies, but what about actually with countries such as Denmark, you know, trying to be carbon free? Are you actually working with governments that will build these?
Well, I tell you the truth.
That's one question. The second, though, is can you say in a few words how it actually, this would be a whole other discussion, how do you actually capture this carbon and transform it and reuse it? It's like recycling it.
Okay.
What is the governments and the others?
So I have to find this. I'm going to just go quickly. I found a typo, by the way. If you want me to, I'll tell you. This is how. So I will explain it to you now.
Just a few words. Yeah.
In step one, input of air. Air goes through monoliths with sorbent. The sorbent catches the CO2. This happens in a chamber that does the air input, and then the chamber is lowered, and then the monolith coated with GET, proprietary amino polymers, selectively mine to the CO2. In step three, we regenerate the sample, which means that we empty the CO2-bound amines. The amines are the sorbents. And step four, we do a heat transfer because this process does not use electricity. It uses only heat. Why is that important? Because if we use electricity, we will be generating CO2, and we don't. Let's talk about Denmark very quickly. Denmark is a wonderful country. Working with them would be fantastic. Governments are slow. And it's very, very difficult. If you can do it, you do it. But we sort of feel the private sector is more dynamic and it's easier to work with the private sector. We would love to work with Denmark. If you have any suggestion and it doesn't take several years, let me know.
Okay.
Yes.
So Coca-Cola will not sequester carbon. It'll go off into the air. Some carbon fiber would. What do you direct your market? Would you direct toward markets that would sequester carbon?
Yes. We have various parts of the firm. And Peter Eisenberger is very radical and doesn't want to do anything, nothing to do with Coca-Cola because it's not carbon negative. He's not wrong. But you know what? You know, you need to go somewhere. So you need to be a bit flexible on how you get there. So yes. Oh, I'm sorry. The Coca-Cola will sequester some CO2 if you drink it and it becomes part of your body. But if you let it off into the air, it will be carbon neutral, not carbon negative. And at the best, I already said, they do 1.5 million tons a year. They're not going to change the world with Coca-Cola. But you know what? It's a very important symbol, Coca-Cola. And if we can do something with them, it's important for us, I believe. This is an ongoing debate between me and Peter Eisenberger. Peter Eisenberger is the guy that you saw in the Scientific American, is my chief technology officer. He used to lead the Exxon research and development globally. And he tried to change Exxon and didn't succeed. So he's very radical on this, and he doesn't want to do anything which is not really carbon negative. Is he right? I don't know. I really don't know. Any other questions? Yes.
Yes, Paul Nydeck.
Nydeck?
Nydeck.
Nydeck.
So a couple questions. You were mentioning that you're in a $25 million round of financing, so assume you get that within a few months. Is one of your other impediments additional venture capital?
Yeah. It is difficult to get venture capital for innovation, but we are lucky that our current investors are interested in putting more funding, and they are putting more funding right now, which is good news, and we could use more.
Okay, so do you feel as though that's somewhat of a limitation on your timeline?
Yes, because although each one of our plants makes money, it needs money to make money. So it's a question of finance, timing. And so we do have a limitation that way, yes.
And can you talk more about those five commercial projects you listed in their schedules?
Oh, I can talk so much that you will kick me out of here.
Completion of the CO.
Sorry?
Commercial operation.
Okay, so in each of the cases, we have either a signed or an agreed term sheet. And in some of them, we're already into the definitive agreement. So they more or less take the following form. The first few are paying themselves for the capex. So that's a firm called Global Power in Israel. They want to produce CO2 to feed water desalination plant, and those pay $250 per ton, which is a good margin. And they have a deal with us to pay for the commercial plan. They will build it, they will pay the capex and everything. And they will get a limited amount of CO2 for a certain amount of time without paying extra. You will say, why are you giving them this deal, Graciela? What do you think you're doing? Not so fast. What's your first name?
Paul.
No, because when you do your first commercial demo plant and you want to demonstrate your commercialization, you have to be willing to sell your firstborn. So you have to be flexible here. This is a very new technology, so we're doing it. Next one, Coca-Cola. Next one, Pepsi. I was talking with Pepsi today. They want to start by doing plants in some of their bottlers. And how much? Well, we had two business models. One is we can charge them the same that they are paying now, but give them carbon negative CO2. Or we can do something different and offer them the lowest price, which is $100 a ton, very low. And you know what? We don't know which one to do. And I am between the two because I feel that whatever works, works. Because if I had a contract with Coca-Cola signed and I was producing Coca-Cola CO2 right now, you would be very impressed. So I got to get there, and I'm going to get there no matter what, whatever it takes.
So I heard definitive agreements.
Yes.
Start of construction dates, do you have those?
Yeah, the start of construction dates are going to be in mid-2017. They will take 12 months to build, and they start producing money after that. But in many cases, like for example, in the greenhouses in Australia, we're going to be paid money up front. How? Well, there is the issue of having an escrow account. And then there is the issue that they want us to provide the, you know, to provide some sort of insurance that the technology will work, okay? And we are lucky enough that Edgar Bronfman, our commercial, our executive chairman and our lead investor, has been with us for many years. So he decided he would use his balance sheet. Our balance sheet is...
Yes, but his Edgar, balance sheet is this.
He has like a balance sheet like that. So he's so clear, and so he relies so much and believes so much in our technology because he knows that he's offering guarantee on his balance sheet. He already done that with Coca-Cola, and he's doing it with Pepsi. So that's very valuable.
Very.
Commercial guarantees from Edgar Bronfman. I can show you that. It's unbelievable. I mean, I'm just giving you how. And this is one of the things he doesn't care. Why? Because he knows it works. And he knows me for many years, et cetera, and the CEO, so, you know. But it's still wonderful, right? So anyway, so this, I'm giving you some of the inside issues here, but I can tell you much more.
And last question, Dr. Eisenberg, you
yes.
mentioned Exxon Research.
Yes.
When did he retire from Exxon?
He didn't retire. He worked at Exxon for several years, and then he wanted to transform Exxon into an energy company. That was the case in the 90s, but then, or even before, the 80s? No, I think the 90s. Anyway, Exxon shifted back to petroleum, and he left.
Because I think I worked with him in Clinton, New Jersey.
Yes!
I recall, I see his face, and I said, that's Peter, Peter.
That's Peter, that is Peter.
Right.
You can't miss him.
Right.
He,
right.
By the way, he drives me crazy. Do
yeah,
you know?
He drove us crazy.
Yeah, there you go, see?
Graciela, one more question.
Just don't repeat.
No repeat.
By the way, if you come to Sarai to look at our plant, I will arrange for him to be there.
I wrote down the address.
Yes.
333
Ravenswood.
Menlo Park.
Yeah. You tell me, and then I'll arrange for Peter to be there, and he will. What's your first name again?
Paul.
No, the last name. I'm sorry.
Nydek.
Wait. What are you? A physicist?
I am not a physicist.
Chemical engineer?
Yes.
Ah, we need you there. Chemical engineers don't believe what we're doing.
It's wonderful.
So come over and meet with Peter. I will tell Peter I met with Paul Nydek, who knows you from Clinton. I know, this is amazing.
Right. I was in the finance department at the time.
Well, then you know what I'm talking about. He drives me crazy, personally.
I can understand.
But he's very, very good. I'm sorry. We are not supposed to be gossiping here.
Gossip after.
Huh? Sorry?
Stick around after.
Yes. Any other, one more question? Two more questions, but very quick. My answers, very quick.
I'm Lan, and I have a quick question about
name. Name.
My name is Lan.
Lan.
And I have a quick question about the energy industry. Like you say that, I think this is very good technology that can change the climate, like the solution for climate change, and I just wonder how it can affect the energy industry and how it can reduce or affect the coal companies or like oil and natural gas production as well as the prices.
So what, you have a question or just want to give me a pat in my back, which I need?
No.
How
does it affect?
How does it what?
Like if this technology can be implemented in,
it's being implemented right now.
I mean like over the whole globe.
Oh, you mean to say scale up?
Mm-hmm. And how it gonna affect the price as well as the energy production of like fossil fuels and
the price is going to go down even further. The scale up is going to be John, what's your name?
John.
Yeah, John said the price is going to be related to the application, and materials are probably the one that has the largest scale to scale up, as we discussed. And probably in developing countries, probably in India and China. But in the meantime, we're going to start here because the margins are larger. For example, if you go for beverages, you can get much more money, but the market is smaller. And if you wanted to do, for example, enhance oil recovery that Peter Eisenberg doesn't want to do, but you get a lot of money, but the margins, and there are millions of tons, but the margins are small. So you have a market in which for small amounts, you have a large margin, make a lot of money, but small amounts, and then large applications like materials, like plastic, and enhanced oil recovery, small margins, large markets. So there is a trade-off curve, and we are basically negotiating that. That's the way to do it.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.